good to see each one of you this morning here at Emit Grove Baptist Church. I'm going to ask you, if you would, to grab your Bibles, your copy of God's Word, and turn with me to Psalm 121 in verses 1 through 4. And as you're doing so, won't you stand with me as well as we show respect to the reading of the Word of God this morning. Psalm 121 in verses 1 through 4. This morning's sermon is entitled, The Constant Helper. And certainly he is that. Psalm 121 in verses 1 through 4. I will lift my eyes to the mountains or to the hills. From where shall my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to slip. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. Let us pray. Lord God, as we consider this text this morning, we pray for divine inspiration through the Spirit of God that we might receive illumination into this text and understanding in regards to what you're communicating. Yes, then, but also now today, God, to us, to speak to our hearts, to speak to our minds, to speak to our souls, oh God. That is what we desire, what we yearn for, what we long for this morning, oh God. And so I just pray that we would come before you with humility, asking that we might be cleansed of our sins, asking that the enemy might be bound, asking that we might be humbled in your presence, that you would speak to us, God. For what is the Word of God without the Spirit of God? Lord, just lead us and guide us into this truth this morning and break our hearts for what breaks yours, God, and just help us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. A country preacher decided to skip church services one day to go hiking in the wilderness. Rounding a sharp bend in the trail, he collided with a bear. Slight issue there, huh? He collided with a bear and was sent tumbling down a steep grade. He landed on a rock and he broke both of his legs. With the ferocious bear charging at him from a distance, the preacher started to pray. Oh Lord, I'm so sorry for skipping the services today. Please forgive me and just grant this one wish. Make a Christian out of that bear that's coming at me. At that very instant, the bear skidded to a halt, fell to his knees, collapsed his paws together, and began to pray aloud at the preacher's feet. Dear God, bless this food I'm about to receive. You know, God provides help, does he not? He is the constant helper, but get this, with that humorous illustration, it's not always the help we want. Or maybe the help that we desire. But he is a God of help, is he not? He is our helper. Jehovah Ezer, the Lord my help, is the Hebrew name of God that we consider as we look into this psalm. And God is a God of help. Maybe it's not the help that you say that you want, but you really do want that help, because ultimately you really don't know what you want. You really have no idea what you need. You think that you want certain things or you need certain things, but those have been cultivated and created in you by a fallen society that has no clue who God is. God knows what you want, and he knows what you need. You think about our desires, and we say that we desire this or we desire that, but really our desires have been shaped and cultivated by a fallen world away from God. And so when we come to God, we begin to gain clarity of mind and proper perspective about the reality of really what we want and what we need, and what we want ultimately truly is the person of Jesus Christ. So many people say, I don't want God. I really believe that every person ultimately wants God. They just don't know it. And that's why they pour themselves into so many different things, looking for something to fill them. But the help, my friends, is available right here in the person of Jesus Christ. We look into Psalms 120 through 134, and they're called Psalms of Ascent. Means to go up. They're also called Pilgrim Psalms. 10 are anonymous, 4 are attributed to David, and 1 to Solomon. They form something of a traveler's psalm or a pilgrim's hymnal, as the Hebrew people would go up to Jerusalem to celebrate their 3 major annual feasts, Passover, Pentecost, and the Tabernacles. They would sing and parade these psalms understanding their help and where it indeed came from. Yahweh or Jehovah is mentioned 5 times. Help for God's people does not come from Baal or any ancient false god. Help comes from the Lord God, who is true. Help does not come in our modern day from idols, from materialism, from politicians. Certainly not. Help comes from God. What is real help and what is false help? What is genuine and what is superficial? What is the truth and what is the lie? We serve El Emet, and he is the God of truth. And he is our constant and real help. Help outside of him is indeed no help at all. No, the only one we can truly count on any day and any time is the Lord, who is constant, steadfast, and he is never changing in an ever-changing world that's constantly shifting. And our morals, they change, and the way we think changes, and everything's changing, but God remains the same. And we redefine, and we corrupt, and we break, and we destroy, but God remains the same. He is the helper, amen. Do you know the helper this morning? Do you know about the helper? Do you have head knowledge of the helper? Or do you know the helper? Do you have a heart relationship with the helper? And is this more than just hearing? Is this knowing? Do you know him? Are you walking with him? Is he preserving you? Is he helping you? Is he upholding you by your mighty right hand? Is he with you? If this God is with you, won't you do me a favor? I know a lot of you aren't talking yet, but I'm about to get you to right here. Say amen. Amen. He's with you. You know, I'll say this. I know I've got a lot of inadequacies. I'm just pathetic. Amen. I just heard my dad say that's a double amen right here too. But I'll say this at the same time. I honestly believe in my heart. Literally, I really believe this. I believe that God is with me. I'm telling you, I honestly believe that. Do you believe that? That's a game changer. That really is. Do you believe that about yourself? That God is with you through the person of Jesus Christ? I honestly believe that about myself. Do you believe that about yourself this morning? Humbly. That you have him in your life, that he's walking with you, that there is help that is with you, that I've got help with me, that his sustaining grace and mercy, that his compassion is with me, amen, that his love is with me, that this God is with me. Certainly the Hebrew people would have to understand that this God was with them as they made this journey. And let us consider this God as we make this pilgrim journey called life and not make the same mistakes as the Hebrew people. As I ponder this psalm again, Jehovah Ezer comes to mind. Let's look into verses 1 and 2. My Lord's power is before me. Notice what the psalmist is going to say here in verses 1 and 2. I lift my eyes to the mountains. Where shall my help come from? The mountains, the hills, they're a safe haven for robbers and petty terrorists. They pointed and led to Jerusalem. So as they thought about the hills, this was an occasion for anxiety, for worry on one hand, but anticipation on the other, because if we make it past the hills, then we're going to worship God. But the hills are dangerous. The hills are troublesome. And so we consider this word help is from the Hebrew word Ezer. The psalmist is asking, who is the one who will keep me from stumbling along life's journey? Where is the one who will help me get there, to make it there so that I can worship? Where is he who will overshadow me and he who will keep me by his side? Where is he who will keep me from evil, never leave me nor forsake me? Where is he, the psalmist is asking in verse 1? Where is this one? Where is this person? Is there such a one? Is this accomplished? Is this possible? And verse 2 is going to answer his question. Notice this, my help comes from the Lord. My help comes from God. I pray that you know this morning, that you've experienced this. Have you experienced his help, his hand of goodness and mercy in your life, who made heaven and earth, Elohim, creator, God. He is everything. The one who made them, from the one who made the hills to the one who made the universe. This is an argument from the smaller to the greater. The creator God of Genesis 1 and 2 is his power source, his help in times of trouble and difficulty. Yahweh made heaven and earth. He made me and he cares for me. His power, his presence, his knowledge is great. He is powerful. He is personal, yet he is knowing me and he's walking with me. The same God who made everything that we can see and beyond, the very same God is walking with me this morning. And John 1, Colossians 1, and Hebrews 1 would reveal that this great and awesome creator is also our great and awesome redeemer that we find in Jesus Christ. There is no separation between God the Father and God the Son. To know God the Father, you must know God the Son. A lot of people talk about God, and you can say God all day long, but that doesn't mean a thing unless you mention the person of Jesus Christ. Because if you don't know the Son, then my friends, know this, you don't know the Father. You don't know the Father, the power of this name, the power of God. My help comes from the Lord. My sustenance comes from the Lord, the bread of life. My thirst is taken care of by the Lord, the water of life. He has raised me up. He has resurrected me. He is the resurrection and the life. He is my life. That we would understand him in this way, that this God is for me. And if this God is for you, then who can be against you? The Lord, my help. Is he your help? My Lord's providence is with me in verses 3 and 4. It says this: He will not allow your foot to slip. He who keeps you will not slumber. Boy, there's an emotional, spiritual, psychological component to the Psalms, is there not? The Psalms really touch at something more, don't they? I believe the Psalms really touch to the depth of our soul, to our spirituality, and you're all spiritual beings, so I think, you know, we need to wake up and pay attention to the text, amen. You know, so many go to counseling, and you're going to go see your psychologist, but man, this is psychology at its depth and at its core right here, amen. Touching your heart, touching your soul, touching your being, because he's speaking beyond. You just read these words and read this text, but if you don't go deeper into this text, you're not really understanding what the psalmist is saying. He is reaching out to grab your heart. He is seeking to grab your soul. David was a man after God's own heart, yet David committed murder and adultery, and maybe he didn't write this psalm, but he wrote most of them, and this sounds very familiar in a way. But how was David a man after God's own heart? But he had a spiritual longing and hunger and thirst for God. He touched at the core of our spirituality. And the psalm does that. It does the very same thing. The Lord's providence is with me. He will not allow your foot to slip. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither sleep nor slumber. Never. He is always there. This is the change from the first to the third person as the psalmist dialogues within his soul. This is healthy soul talk. You ever talk to yourself? I talk to myself. Now, I may not let many of you see it because you'll probably think, wow, he's wacko. But I talk to myself. I have to sometimes. I talk to myself and my thoughts start getting kind of negative, and I can tell the enemy's trying to reach into me and bring me down. That's not true. I know God has said this. He talks to himself. It's good to talk to you. And my dad talks to himself all the time. You better believe that. And he'll talk to himself in front of the whole congregation too sometimes. Look out. But he talks to himself with this healthy soul talk. There are four negatives that appear crucial to the argument of these two verses. The God who guards his people, Israel, is the same God who guards me now on a day-by-day basis. He will not allow your foot to slip, to slide, to stagger, be shaken. He tells us there is a moment-by-moment watch care over us by Jehovah. His eye is on me. His eye is on you. his eye and also his hand. Amen. I pray. My grandfather used to say this to me, Huffy, my father's father. He would say, God has his hand on you. Don't take it off. And I pray that for you this morning also. I know that God has his hand on so many of you. Don't take it off. Don't take it off. The goodness, the grace, the mercy of God puts his hand on you. Don't take it off. You think God takes his hand off? God doesn't take his hand off. You take his hand off. We take his hand off. Don't take his hand off. He is guarding us and he is guiding us. He keeps us. Jude picks up on this aspect of God's character by applying it to the security of the believer in salvation. Jude 24 and 25 says this, "Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy to God our Savior, the one who alone is wise, to be glory and majesty, dominion and power both now and forever. Amen." The God that takes care of me. The God that's going to get me there. The God that's going to provide for me. That God, to him be glory forever and ever. Amen. You think about this. The pagan gods need sleep. They need rest. Not Jehovah. He does not slumber or doze off, nor does he sleep. He does not get tired. He doesn't take naps. He doesn't sleep. He doesn't eat. He doesn't have to do anything else. He is constantly watching those who are belonging to him, who love the Lord their God with all their heart, their soul, their mind, who are honoring him, those he is for and he is taking care of. Amen. He's with those that are with him. He's for those that are for him. Psalm 34:15 says, "The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous and his ears are open to their cry." Know this, you are immortal until the will of God is accomplished in your life. I firmly believe that, amen. You are immortal until the will of God is accomplished in your life as long as you're seeking the will of God. And what is the will of God? That we might fulfill the will of God. And because of Jesus Christ and his sacrifice, know this, I have a helper this morning, and so I've got a helper, and so God is now calling me to do something. What is God calling me to do? I know what he's calling me to do. Now, what is God calling you to do? You should know what God is calling you to do. Will you say the will of God is a mystery? No, it's not. Fall in love with God, and you'll find the will of God. You know that? The will of God, people think it's 10,000 miles away. I'll never know what God wants for me. I don't have a clue, Pastor. You're talking above my head. I don't even begin to get that. You just fall in love with God, and naturally the will of God comes. There is not that big of a disconnect. And so what God has called you to, now you go and do it, and in this we find what it means to really live life, amen. You know, I'm not here to live this American dream. I'm really not. I'm here to live God's dream for my life, his plan for my life. And you know, folks, I really think that we've done a disservice here. We've oftentimes stated that, in fact, the American dream is part of God's dream for us, but I believe that's a pack of lies. Put that in Joel Osteen's bestseller, because it's not the truth, amen? We're not here for me. In fact, I disgust myself. I make myself miserable. I never satisfy myself. Everything that my flesh wants that I get into, I overindulge and I disappoint myself and I come away feeling down and blue. Isn't that the truth for all of us? I've never satisfied myself, not one time. It's disgusting, it really is. But God, he is always satisfying. In fact, he always just gives an overabundance, an oversupply. Every time I come to him, I am shocked and amazed by the goodness of God. And I can't believe what I've missed out on. Boy, that is God's goodness in our life, his hand in our life. You think that God is seeking to take things away from me and deny me from pleasures? Man, that's a pack of lies. God wants to fill my soul. He wants to bring my spirit to life. He wants to encourage me. He wants to give me joy, this overflowing happiness that can't be controlled. Amen. And when we walk in this way, truly we become aliens in a dead, lost, and dying world. And the world then looks at us and says, whoa, there's something about them that makes them different. Truly, folks, that is God's desire for the church. That the church would look like that. And then the world would look at the church. And the world would say, man, they're different. They're not like us. I want what they've got. I've got to have it. You know, sadly though, so often now the world looks at the church and says, there's no difference. There's no difference. There's a big difference. Amen. There's a big difference. Won't we enjoy the difference? The difference maker is Jesus Christ. The difference maker is Jesus Christ. Have you been born of him? Are you in the church but not a part of the church? Amen. Do you know him, the difference maker, who is Jesus Christ, who is the helper? Are you experiencing this help this morning? Are you just going through the motions of life? Are you sucked into the lie? Are you living to the fullness for his honor and for his glory this morning? Because of Jesus and his sacrifice, I have a constant helper this morning. John 14, 15 through 20 says this, if you love me, keep my commands. And I will ask the Father, he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me because I live. You will also live. On that day, you will realize that I am in the Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Jesus talking to his disciples, but certainly there's a broader context of application here as well. The Spirit of God. The Spirit of God. You know, when I was 21, and I always go back, you know, but you read Paul, and he never gets over his testimony, does he? He never gets over God's grace and mercy in his life. When I was 21 and I went forward for help. I wanted help. You know, when you really ask God for help, you know what God does? He gives you help. The reason you don't get help is because you don't want help. Not really. When I was 21, though, I really felt God call me. Man, it was real. It was so real. And God is so real now, obviously. But I really wanted help. Like, I really wanted help. And I meant it. I meant help. I meant need help. And, you know, when I got there, I got to the front, I had an experience with the helper. You know what the helper did for me? Boy, I came just absolutely, totally guilted and sin-ridden and burdened down and lifeless, no life. Just go through the motions, live in the moment. That's not living, that's a lie. I didn't know I was living a lie, but I was living a lie. But when I got there, the helper walked up to me. Boy, if you could have looked into the spiritual world, into the invisible world, which you cannot see, what is so real, you would have seen something going on. And the helper grabbed all of the sin and all of the guilt and all of the shame, and he stripped it off of me. And you know what he did? He set my soul free. He gave me life. I was held down before. I was trapped. I couldn't get out, and I was never getting out. Amen. This is your story also. Apply it to yourself. You were held down. You were trapped. You couldn't get out. You couldn't get out, and you were never getting out. Satan had you like the dog chained to the tree. Try as you might, run as fast as you could. You could never break the chain. He pulled it all off. And then you know what he did? He jumped inside of me. He really did. He pulled it all off. And then he jumped inside of me. And he filled me with something that I'd never felt before. the thought was walking away from there. Dear God in heaven, in this postmodern world, and I'm in college, I'm getting ready to graduate, and I've been told that these are Bible thumpers that aren't really that intelligent, uneducated, narrow-minded. Most of them are elephants too, politically speaking. I found the truth in here. The thought was, this is unbelievable. Can you really fathom that the truth is in a Southern Baptist church in South Georgia? Comprehend that. But yet, as I've come to know, that is who our God is. He is for the humble. He is for the powerless. He is for those that aren't capable. He is for the weak, not the strong. He is for the meek. This is the God. I walked away with his power. When you were saved, you walked away with his power. And you've never been the same. And you face a lot of trials and a lot of turmoil in life, but you've got this power source within you that enables you to keep going whatever comes your way. You make it not because of yourself or your determination or what you have, but because of the God who is with you and for you. Because that power, have you experienced that power? Are you walking in that power this morning? The victorious Christian life is found not in yourself, but in him who is Jesus Christ. Amen. Know that, walk in that way. So many of you say, what about my problems? What about my trouble? Let me end with this as our musicians get ready to come. Grace is God drawing sinners closer and closer to him. How does God and grace prosecute this purpose? Not by shielding us from assault by the work, the flesh, and the devil, nor by protecting us from burdensome and frustrating circumstance. Not yet by shielding us from troubles created by our own temperament and psychology, but rather by exposing us to all these things so as to overwhelm us with a sense of our own inadequacy and to drive us to cling to him more closely. Listen to this. This is the ultimate reason from our standpoint why God fills our lives with troubles and perplexities of one sort and another. It is to ensure that we shall learn hold fast to him. The reason why the Bible spends so much time reiterating that God is a strong rock, a firm defense, and a sure refuge, and help for the weak, is that God spends so much of his time showing us that we are weak, both mentally and morally, and dare not that we trust ourselves to find and follow the right road. When we walk along a clear road feeling fine and someone seeks to grab our arm to help us, likely we would impatiently shake him off. But when we are caught in rough country in the dark with a storm brewing and our strength spent and someone takes our arm to help us, we would thankfully lean on him. Praise God for the troubles. Praise God for the pains. And God wants us to feel that our way through life is rough and perplexing so that we may learn lean on him. Therefore, he takes steps to drive us out of the self-confidence and to trust in himself and to learn to wait on him. Let me ask you this question. Let me say this. Where does my help come from? It comes from the Lord God, or it doesn't come at all. Where does your help come from? It comes from the Lord God, or it doesn't come at all. Won't you stand with me, and we're going to have this invitation. And if you need help this morning, I just believe there's a spiritual world. I believe it's so real. It is really the real world. And I believe there's a God here that wants to help you. Won't you allow him to help you this morning?